had these slides for a while, and I thought about changing to the new Levine Cancer Institute logo. Colors are better on this one, so I'll have to work on my slide set. But suffice to say, I decided to leave it this way in part because Interleukin-2 has been around for a while. It was approved in 1998, and we'll talk about that. The crux of what I'm going to say is it is a remarkable step forward, and it still cures people every day who have advanced melanoma. Not sure we can say that about our newer drugs, ones that have been around long enough. But this is a tool that, when done safely, can change people's lives. So we all know this. This is a lovely lady of mine who's actually done beautifully. This is an obvious melanoma on the stomach. This is an obvious melanoma on the back. This is an excised melanoma, recurrent melanoma on the face. And a man who elected to undergo a complete lymph node dissection at a time when sentinel node was just getting started. A talk for another day, and you can see this incision actually comes all the way to about there. I want to, whenever I give a talk about melanoma, I've been taking care of melanoma patients now for almost 20 years. I remind myself of this fellow. He's an artist, and this is a self-portrait. And I don't think you can miss the fact that his melanoma started on his back, and he had multiple wide incisions of that lesion. And the saddest part is that he died at age 25. I have this painting. The problem, obviously, is I don't know where to put it. I think about it almost every day because I think this exemplifies for most patients with melanoma what it means in a very visceral way, certainly on some days. I also remember this fellow who was my father, who died of melanoma in 1966. I actually give a talk comparing what we did in 1966 to what we do currently. We don't have time to go through all that today, but we'll touch upon some of those aspects today. So these are the stages of melanoma. Virtually everybody in this room understands what staging means. But we're going to focus today on stage 4, and I want to point out these curves. You're going to see a lot of these curves today. And it's proportion of survival. So imagine this is 100%. This is when we start measuring things. So everybody's alive at the start of this. And this is survival over years. And you can see a proportion surviving over a number of years. And the focus, as I mentioned today, would be on stage 4 disease, with a median, in other words, 50% survival of well under a year. And this depends largely on whether how many sites of disease you have. If you have one site, you can see that the median survival, well under a year, be substantial. Some of that we'll talk about in a minute. Two sites, you notice this curve reaches zero, and three sites you can see historically the survival is essentially done a year. When we talk about phrases visceral and non-visceral, visceral to us doctors means things like liver, lung. Non-visceral primarily means skin, lymph nodes. So what are the treatment options? The treatment options, or as I like to say, and many of you in the room have actually heard me say, we've got a number of tools in the toolbox. The tools in the toolbox are surgery, chemotherapy, either given as one agent or many agents combined, immunotherapy, particularly IL-2-based immunotherapy, and now, the great thing is, by the way, I've had this slide for 15 years almost. The great thing is, now I put the others on there. That's the latest addition. And we'll talk about those. Now, I always remind people that surgery is a powerful tool in the treatment of melanoma. In fact, the vast majority of patients with melanoma are cured in the operating room. There's 61,000 melanomas a year. There are about 8,000 deaths. The vast majority of people, I'm lucky enough to say I'm cured. The problem is I have no idea who it is I've cured, which is a little disappointing. I mean, I thought I was going to get some great big reaction with like a S on it. I can tell you that probably kind of made you later, but not on the digital operation. I've shown you the numbers of survival, and now I'll show you that if you operate on soft tissue, patients with soft tissue metastases, the median survival means half are on one side of that and half are on the other side of that. It's anywhere between 9 and 50 months, and the 5-year survivals in properly selected patients can be anywhere between 10 and 50%. Lymph node metastases, anywhere between 11 and 38%. Intestinal metastases, 28%. Lung metastases, again, these are highly selected patients, so it's not a broad, you know, if I have 5 or 6 lung lesions, I'm a candidate for surgical excision. No, that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about somebody who's got 1 or 2 lesions that have been present for a period of time with no other things coming up. We can do quite well. And even in highly selected patients with brain metastases, you can see some people do quite well. Now, I'm not going to go through this. This is a very confusing slide. Suffice it to say, virtually every chemotherapy agent that anybody's ever come up with has been tested in melanoma. The phrase you're going to see over and over again is CR, meaning complete response. In other words, 10 different spots. You give the chemotherapy, do these spots go away? Partial response means shrinkage of 50% or more. You'll see this phrase occasionally, which is confidence interval. In other words, yeah, how many patients are in there and what's the range that actually might fall into. But suffice it to say, you can see numbers that vary between 15% and 20% of people having any kind of response at all. In other words, any shrinkage whatsoever. And these are reports usually from single institutions in highly selected patients. And then the notion became particularly popular, particularly at MD Anderson. See, Lega popularized this. A combination of multiple drugs, figuring sometimes more is better, with the response rates now that are better, and complete response, up to 10% of people having it go away. And this led to a substantial trial that compared the most common agent, DTIC, to what's called the Dartmouth regimen, in other words, multiple drugs put together. And when tested in a much more objective fashion, much more, many more institutions participating, very strict entry criteria, the complete response rate was sadly zero. The overall response rate is approximately 10%. The median survival is sadly no different than the slides I showed you before. In other words, it hasn't changed the mean survival at all. And the one-year survival is on the order of 22-27%. The problem with this study with the Dartmouth regimen, in other words, multiple agents, had lots more toxicity. Patients were much sicker. So in most parts of the United States, multi-drug regimens are not in common use, with some exceptions. So what can we conclude about chemotherapy? And I'm giving you a very brief overview. Complete responses are rare. Responses are rarely durable. Chemotherapy has substantial toxicity. And sadly, we were able to drive up the response rate, in other words, more shrinkage of tumor, but that did not seem to translate into living life. Now, in the midst of all this, a compound called Interleukin 2 was described originally by Gallo, who was looking to grow T cells, which you'll hear more about in a minute. In the laboratory, he had substantial trouble keeping them alive. And after slaughtering several thousand mice, he was able to identify this compound, ultimately called Interleukin 2, which helped these T cells grow. A major understatement for the function of Interleukin 2 is it's involved in immune regulation because it can stimulate these T cells, which we call activated T cells. I'm not going to go through this in great detail, but suffice it to say that interleukin-2 has activity on multiple different classes of cells. So you give interleukin-2, it has effects virtually throughout the immune system, but also at almost every level of the human body. Now, I borrowed the cell from a company that's been involved in the Interleukin 2. Frankly, these big green things are tumor cells. These are T cells, and you can see them interact. And when activated, they can destroy the T cells. Now, back in the old days, in the 1980s, it was not uncommon to take a drug and push it as far as you could in what are called phase one trials. In other words, you gave the medicine until toxicity was breached. You then tried to find, at that level of toxicity, whether it would have any impact on patients. The National Cancer Institute, under the direction of Dr. Steven Rosenberg, took interleukin 2 and said, you know, we can demonstrate, and I have not shown you the laboratory data, but in an animal model, you can give interleukin 2 and make melanoma tumors go away almost with regularity. And it appeared to be dose dependent. And after a number of experiments, interleukin 2, the two dosing regimens here, were tested in what are called phase two trials. In other words, what's it going to do to the patient? And what's it going to do to the patients with melanoma? And so the course of therapy was derived for interleukin 2. Basically, gave you as much of the interleukin 2 as you could over a 5 to 6 day period of time, rest for 7 to 10 days, come back to it again, and see how it worked. Well, lo and behold, it worked. And it was the first demonstration that you could manipulate the immune system, because I can take interleukin 2 and pour it on tumor, and it does nothing to the tumor whatsoever. Nothing. But you could stimulate the immune system. And in this patient with, and I will tell you that this is a normal-looking chest x-ray, this is not. Every one of these spots represents metastatic melanoma. This individual probably has a survival measure in the order of 4 to 5 months. And you can see 2 years later, the patient is the individuals without disease and doing extremely well. This slide is a little busy, but at the end of the day, about 15% of patients in melanoma. Would I love it to be 85%? Absolutely. But the remarkable thing is that a group of individuals with advanced melanoma are now having their disease go away entirely with manipulation of their immune system. And in fact, these patients, these pluses all represent, this is the number of months. This is plus means it's an ongoing response. This is data from the National Cancer Institute, which was then amalgamated into a larger report authored by Mike Atkins in Boston. We looked at patients outside of the National Cancer Institute as well, and about 6% of patients had all their disease go away, and the median response duration had not been achieved. In other words, once you had it all go away, it wasn't coming back. In addition, those patients who had partial responses, noted here, they did have the disease come back. At the time of the report, 28% of the responding patients and 59% of the patients who achieved a complete response were without return of their melanoma. And based on this, the FDA approved the drug in 1998. This is the survival curve of the patients who were treated. You can see, this is 5 years, you can see a number of patients, granted not anything like what we would like to see. It's certainly a remarkable number of patients alive and doing well. And this is why the FDA approved this, and this is why we continue to treat patients regularly every day with this medicine. If the disease goes away, in the vast majority of individuals, it does not come back. I want you to look at the lower axis here. This is survival time, not in months, but in years. So if the disease goes away, I hesitate to use the word cure, but we're talking about people who are 7, 8, 9, 10, 15 years out without recurrence of widespread metastatic lethal melanoma. Let's take this fellow, 36-year-old, wide excision of an upper extremity lesion, got vaccination. I will tell you, unfortunately, there's, with the exception of one study that we were involved in recently, there's not a lot of evidence that vaccination can be of help. He then recurred, multiple spots. I saw him in 1998. He was treated with one course of interleukin 2, and the disease went away within 7 days. This is what's called a PET scan. You'll see a lot of these. The brain is used, the uptake of glucose, which is tagged or radioactive isotope. Melanoma tends to take this up. So every one of these white spots here, and even the grayer spots, represent metastatic melanoma. This is after Interleukin 2. This is his brain. This is his heart. Those are supposed to be there. You can see all the other spots have gone away. Here's another patient of ours, more recent. Large, massive melanoma. Very large. Easily something you can feel. With complete resolution, you can see the scans were just done a few weeks ago. Now, the problem with Interleukin 2 is that it takes a team that knows how to give it safely. Does it need to be administered in a place that knows how to do it? Absolutely. This is a medication that when used in inexperienced hands can be very toxic and even fatal. But with patient selection and experience in managing the side effects, the NIH, for example, treated 809 consecutive patients with no treatment-related deaths. Now, I would argue they are pushing the envelope part-time. But suffice it to say, in centers such as theirs and centers such as ours, I'll show you our data in a few minutes, this can be done quite safely. Well, who's going to be a good candidate for Interleukin 2? We have a scoring system in oncology called the ECOG performance status. Bottom line is if you're fit, you're well, you're walking around, you have activities of different daily life are completely unlimited, you can do whatever you want, that's ECOG 0. Some symptoms, 1, more symptoms, 2. And the bottom line is if you're, the bottom line is if your performance status is excellent, that's a predictor of how you're going to do. This is not a treatment for people who are now ill from their melanoma. And that's a very important point as we move forward with these new drugs. We do not want to treat people with some drug, other drug, and then say, okay, well, now we're going to do the Interleukin 2 now that you are having symptoms. That's an inappropriate way to look at this tool. But responses have been observed in patients with metastases virtually everywhere in the body. Is it much more common to have these metastases respond in the skin and the lymph nodes? Yes. But that's not to say they can't respond elsewhere. Thank you. These are the cycles of intravenous interleukin 2 given here through 2010. You can see each year. 2002 was a really busy year. And arguably, what had happened in that year was a lot of things to do with insurance. The groups in Boston were effectively prohibited for a period of time from giving interleukin 2 due to cost concerns. A lot of those patients actually ended up here. With the great support of our administration, we just kept administering it without those concerns. Interestingly, you'll see these dips in that this is both melanoma and kidney cancer patients. This dip is right after some of the new drugs were approved in kidney cancer. The limitations of those drugs have become manifest. You can see the numbers are back up where we were in the mid-2000s. These are the number of new patients. You can see this dip related to the new drugs approved in kidney cancer came right back up as people became familiar with some of the limitations. I expect to see this in melanoma. I have concerns about that for the reasons I've stated in a minute. And this is our data. Not terribly dissimilar to what we saw at the NIH, which is if you have a complete response, that lasts a very long time. And you can see our partial responder group has done a little better than the NIH, partly because we're very particular about what we call a response. But in those patients, once again, who get a response, this can have a remarkably positive effect. I should also note that we've treated about 310 patients, and we've had 2 deaths. One of those, frankly, was my mistake. I treated a fellow with a widely advanced melanoma with very large lesions in his liver. In this day and age, frankly, I would not treat them. Unfortunately, about 2 weeks after his therapy, his liver lesion ruptured, and that was not something we could fix. But we've proven that we can do this safely, yes, as opposed to the institutions that do this on a regular basis. What do we know about interleukin 2? It has a very powerful effect on the immune system. I haven't had a chance to go through that with you, but it's a pluripotent agent. It can produce profound and long-lasting tumor shrinkage in a group of patients with widespread melanoma. It can offer patients with advanced melanoma the hope of long-lasting reversal of their disease. So we and others have spent a lot of time thinking about where do we go with these new drugs. In fact, I was involved with a group at the biologic therapy, involved in biologic therapy, looking at algorithms for the biologic therapy of malignancies. And I was proud to say, as one of the surgeons who participated in that discussion, that there was a recognition among the entire group of the power of surgery in selected patients. If a group of surgeons in concert with their medical oncologists say, yeah, I think this is surgically resectable to the point that we remove all the tumor, we should certainly consider surgery first and foremost, because we have documented over and over again that we can cure patients with the advanced melanoma. Interleukin 2. This is particularly in patients with disease limited to the lung, skin, and nodes, and who are healthy. We've shown that it can lead to, and I use the word cures, we've repeatedly shown that patients can do very well for long periods of time. We can argue about the word cure. Benefit can be generally assessed in 6 to 8 weeks. I showed you the course of therapy, and generally most of those patients who get a complete response, we can figure this out in about 6 to 8 weeks. And frankly, if they're not responding, we can move on to another treatment. I should note that the only side effects you have for the most part is during your time of therapy. So when you're at home, many of our patients leave on a Saturday and Sunday, they're back at work on Wednesday or Thursday playing golf or whatever they want to do. Poor candidates for interleukin 2, and I've alluded to this a moment ago, are those who have rapidly progressing disease, those who have brain disease, those who are generally poor health, in other words, heart disease, lung disease, they're generally not candidates because of some of the side effects associated with interleukin 2, and bulky liver disease. So thank you for your attention, we do have a Q&A session at the end, so please write down your questions, and I'll be happy to answer them for you as we move forward and move on. I've actually stayed on time, which is quite unusual.